Mozambique, Angola, Rwanda, Nigeria, Morocco, Tunisia, and Ghana.
A true born African.
A screening of the film Rebels Outta Vienna took place at the University of Vienna, followed by a panel discussion on June 15, 2023. Rebels Outta Vienna, a documentary film taking stock of the Viennese reggae scene and its diverging divergence with the Afro-Caribbean Rastafarian movement. The film explores local scene peculiarities in the context of global sounds and world views. It provides an intimate insight into views and narratives and thus makes a contribution to the audiovisual archiving of Vienna's music and cultural history. After the 30-minute film screening, there was a panel discussion from 7 to 8 p.m. It was a discussion on the topic of Rastafari and reggae in Vienna with the filmmaker Sebastian Schwager and with two of the protagonists of the film, such as Elder Ras Kella Waller and Rastafari musician Coleman, as well as anthropologist Professor Werner Zips, who also took part.
So I would say we get straight into the panel discussion, and we start with Sebastian. Now, welcome again. You have made this movie, Rebels Outta Vienna. How did this movie come about? Why did you want to make this movie? And what was your own purpose of making this movie? Maybe you can give us a little introduction for those who have right now seen it and for those on Zoom.
First of all, thank you for the opportunity to really show this movie again in a different occasion than the cinema. Also in a scientific context, I'm very happy about this. Thank you for the invitation. And about the movie, well, I have to tell maybe the background story about it. The movie took me quite some time. It was absolutely not funded or anything. It was a no-budget project, basically. And it started all with my bachelor thesis back in 2012, when I was still a bachelor student. And I wrote my bachelor thesis about reggae artists in Vienna and their views on Rastafari. It was also supervised by Professor Werner Zips at the time. And of course, I had to record the interview so that I can transcribe them later and put them in the text. So I just filmed it with no intention, to be honest. And after some time, I was like, well, those people, they have really interesting things to say. And maybe I do a documentary in the future. So some of the footage you have seen in the film is really dating back to 2012, like with Tina, for example, or even with Professor, it was from 2013. And after my bachelor, I was working a little bit on the movie step by step, but there was still a lot of context missing. So by then, I was also grateful that Dominic helped me to get some contacts, like for example to Ras Kella, and I also had some other contacts, for example with Recall, who back in 2013 was not even doing music as a single artist yet, but later on. So yes, I also recorded new stuff, and now it's mixed with my own bachelor thesis videos from the interviews, mixed with some newer stuff like with Ras Kella or Recall or Therapy. Yes, so there was actually no intention in the beginning, but then I was like, the people have something interesting to say, and my intention basically with the movie was also to make people outside of the community, like outside of the Rasta dancer reggae community, to give them something to understand more about the basics of this community and to get to know some main protagonists. But I have to say, of course, the Vienna community is small, for sure, but there are much more people active than what are shown in the film itself. There are much more promoters, artists, or people like Werner Zips who work in, scientifically with these topics, which are not shown in the movie. At least you have your Mimo appearance with Anthony B. but of course, it's only showing a part of the community. And there was no specific choice. It was just that I had certain artists in focus when I did wrote my bachelor thesis. And so, yeah, I got some contacts and.
Well, we have another occasion where you can watch it. It's at the Wiesn One Love Festival in August, and there might be some festivals coming in autumn where we present the movie. Just check out our website rebelsoutofvienna.com for the latest updates and make sure you stay alert.
Why we wanted to show it here at the African Studies Department as part of the Rastafari Reasonings on Africa and Historical Perspective research project, which is to highlight Rastafari Reasonings, and as we have seen in the movie, highlights Rastafari Reasonings quite a lot. Brother Coleman, you were one of the participants in the movie, one of those who brought Rastafari Reasonings into this movie and through this medium of documentary. Now here on our screen. I have also seen this movie in this version now for the first time. There was a first version in which you explained that it was actually in Vienna that you came to Rastafari. And so maybe we can already now get more into the topic of Rastafari in Vienna, and you can tell us a bit of the background. How did you get into Rastafari and reggae music in Vienna? And why was that in Vienna? You originally come from West Africa. And not already maybe in West Africa, maybe you can share a bit of background on that.
Thank you very much. I greet each and everyone in the wonderful name of His Imperial Majesty, the King of Kings, Haile Selassie, Rastafari. Yes, coming to your question, the spirit of reggae music took me all the way before, because of the justice, the focused on, because I used to see divisions and quarrel all over, you know, between tribes and things like this. But when I got to reggae music, the unification they talked about, I just gravitated towards it. But I never knew anything really about Rastafari until when the situation, everything, I didn't even plan to travel, but situation just, everything just pushed me out and I ended up in Vienna. So when I got to Vienna, there was a place called Hot Pepper those days, and I remember I started understanding what reggae music is all about and the position of the King of Kings, Haile Selassie. So then it troubled me so much because I never knew that somebody was even crowned with these titles and everything that Christ is written of Christ. I never had the idea, although we are coming from Christian background. So then I rebelled kind of against it. I didn't know what to do, but I love the reggae so much and the justice in it. But that aspect, sometimes I would be enjoying the reggae music when the name of the man with Haile Selassie comes in between. It would be like I got seizure, you know, because that thing wasn't digesting in me. So, and I tried to look up and down for it. I didn't get anybody who could really help me. Then I came to Jahka once. I was like, what are these people talking about and this? But Jahka started putting Bible for me. I said, okay, I have to, since I call myself a Christian, I don't even know the Bible, like, because there was a song I had also that made me consider what he was saying. It's a song from an artist called Capleton. The song is called No Competition. And in that song, he did boast with the whole Bible, like boasting with Genesis to Revelation, what I couldn't do, you know. So, the song, I would like to, the song goes like, oh, let the word of thy mouth and the meditation of thy heart be acceptable in thy sight, everyone. Then he said, music is a mission, not a competition. But man, I use the music cause confusion. Stray all the woman, them likewise the man. It's like them no respect the Almighty One. Then he said again, Boti Kela must be Bush and Bini must be Saddam. They never listen to the words of the Almighty One. He said, all my strengths are in all musicians, whether you DJ or sing, play song or band. Anyway, boasting with Genesis to Revelation, and that would be my faith, and I couldn't boast with it. And when he was quoting Bible for me again, then I said, I have to go and read the Bible before I argue with these people. You know, so, and things happened that I got in a place where I just focused in just reading this Bible and nothing but the Bible. The more I read the Bible, the more I understand Rastafari, and I have questions for the established religion or Christianity. So, before I know it, the history and the prophecy were speaking for itself, and I went within myself. I was like, now, I've seen these two things are bearing witness, but if there be a creator like this, I would like to have an extra sign.
So as a human being, grew up in a Western hemisphere, in a social, colonial, society background, we didn't appreciate ourselves because we was been taught that we were slaves and we will be slaves all our rest of our life. And the Rasta people was preaching to us that we cannot be slaves anymore, we have to be free and we will have a future. So it is not who can become Rasta, it who wants to be a Rasta. And a Rasta is open for every human being, every nation, no borders. Before, it was origin a Black Power movement. But if any human being would be able to practice these things they was talking about, I realized would be, have been a better human being in many ways. Looking at the development of the movement in Vienna, it makes me feel like being a very successful person as an individual and collective. Because knowing in 30 years ago, Vienna was very, I say, less in numbers in terms of the idea, the behaviors, the cultural movement. And looking at it over from now, the population has grown, the kind of social behavior, the kind of different artists.
Raskelawala, you told me that you first came to Vienna on visits during the 90s, in the early 1990s. And then since 2003, you have been living in Vienna. When you came to Vienna in early 1990s, how did you discover here Rastafari? How did you meet Rastafari here? Can you give us a little insight?
Rastafarian is something I learned when I came here, that nothing is impossible, because in my little island in Saint Lucia, which is the size of Vienna, makes us believe, you know, everything is just there. That's just the world. And that little place is so isolated, so disciplined, so heavenly, is there's nowhere else greater than there. So we always believe there's nobody else out there that can be better than us, a good like we do. So even in that time, I never thought in Vienna would have all these spiritual people who thinking of Rastafarian. When I first heard those names I mentioned as pioneers, who started the movement, who was in their own way giving their devotion musically, artistically, philosophically, in their own way. False Garden, or at that time, which I might mention at that time, sorry, we have lost one of the pioneers I first met, which was Buffalo, Momo was called. He's passed away, at least our sympathy to his he and his friends and family. These movements, and there are many more pioneers who came in, which were not able to be shown as part of the documentary, because the Rastafarian people are people who are resistant to certain things to give out to the public. So maybe Sebastian didn't even have a chance to reach the right resources people to give him all these ancient things, because I came in 2003, so I don't even have the real full time. I would come first 1991, in and out every, spend 3-4 weeks, 1 month, 2 months, and back home. So I never had a time to experience Vienna, to say how the culture, how the music, how the Rasta developed. I was just going in and out. But when I came 2003, I saw how it was boomed everywhere. It was a party, a dance hall, reggae artists, all kind of musicians developed themselves. So I say Vienna was grown into a big capital of reggae music. Other parts of the world had, but Vienna had its own unique way of doing its thing, in its own secretly way, where the people was really rallying, and people have respect for the music, they have respect for the Rastafarian, and they have respect for culture. One of the most things I appreciate for the people who live there, those African heritage people who are living here, I must say thank you for your courage to be able to tolerate the society here and to discipline yourself. Thank you. That's what I can say on observing Rastafarian philosophy, the music, the movements in Vienna.
A typical Rasta must be identified with Rastafari, at least knowing the name you are bearing. If you have the name Rastafari, you have to live and focus onto His Majesty and really step into it, follow it, you know. So you must associate with the lineage of His Majesty. This person who bears the name of Rastafari, no matter where he's coming from, he is telling you about this and trying to tell black man to know himself. It's like he said, this is my father, and without even seeing the complexion. If you have a father and you have siblings, you are connected, it's one blood. A Viennese also played a role in me trying to cite Rastafari. I was asking them because they were dealing with it before me, you know, and things like this. Nobody taught me that in Africa, because all the education is Eurocentric. They tried their best to omit that history of His Majesty.
Thank you very much. And of course, one who was here from the very beginning of reggae and Rastafari in Vienna, Ras Jahka. We are very happy to have you with us today also. Can you tell us, of course, the movie gave is only 30 minutes and only gave some impression on the very current scene, what's going on in reggae music. We saw some pictures of the history in the movement, in the movie, of the history of Rastafari and reggae music in Vienna. You were also on one of those pictures. Can you give us a little insight from how it started, when it started, and how were you involved, and what else you could share a bit about the history of Rastafari and reggae music in Vienna that we didn't see in the movie, which is, as I said, mainly giving an impression of the current reggae scene in Vienna.
Well, first of all, I want to say blessed love to everyone that come out in the name of the Most High Jah Rastafari. I was very fortunate to meet the first Rasta man in Vienna, which was Emsley, as you said. He came from Jamaica. He was living actually in London, but he came to Vienna because his sister was married to an Austrian, and they had the Bununus, which was the first club, not specific a reggae club, but a club for African music, reggae music, soca, calypso, Latin music, all these things were on there. And he had his record shop, which was the Rastaman Vibration. I think you saw the picture. And that is how I came to it. And I was very astonished when first I asked Emsley, so what does it take to be a Rastaman? And when he told me that, you have a Bible at home, you look in the Bible and you read, I was shocked, because for me, I come out of family, my father was Catholic, but he always fight them. My stepmother was, how you call, evangelist. She also not religious. I myself are never religious. So I started to look in it, and of course I could ask him many times if I stuck on. So I read about all these things in the Bible, and the thing he also said to me, don't only read, but try to live it. You see, try to live what you read, put it in your life, put it into practice. And this is how I came to it. I wouldn't say that I'm not grown a Rasta man in that sense, because like I say, I come out of a family that is never nothing to do with religion. So Emsley was the first Rasta man to come to Vienna, and he opened his shop, and he was also a DJ in the Bonononos, and that was late 1979, early 80s somewhere, I don't know exactly, because when I met him, the shop was already open. And from there, this was the first club, the first place where you could see reggae music. A lot of people from the United Nations used to come there. And from there, this thing started to grow. At that time, reggae was not a subject in the media in Austria. Radio, if radio play, they play a little Bob Marley. They play maybe Jimmy Cliff. Even Peter Tosh, you didn't hear, you know. You hear maybe, maybe Clint Eastwood and General Sand, because it's there. Things like Sunshine Reggae, this was the thing at the time, you know. But that was not reggae the way we see reggae, you see. For me, reggae music, it's all about the message, you know. Music is a vehicle to transport the message. And reggae, like we heard in the video also, that it carries a vibes, there's a feeling. You know? I never go to any reggae concert and you see people fighting or people getting aggressive and all these things. You never had that. So a lot of people here in Austria, or Vienna, I cannot talk for the whole Austria, but in Vienna there was, they loved that, you know, they loved that peacefulness, and which also Rastafari bring that in, you know, because there is no, we have no, when I first met Emsley and Rastafari, we never looked at it as a religion in that sense. It was a movement, you know, and that movement is about truth and right, you know, fighting against oppression, you know, but we never look at color of people, or even nowadays you find that some Rasta, they tell you, oh, you must not eat this, you must not drink this. All these things was never there, you know, it was about love. Love to each and everyone, you know. And that is still what remains to me, you know, which is more important. For me, I don't care where a man come from. Many friends that I have from those days, I couldn't even tell you which country they came from. Mm-hmm. Because we never ever think of that. You are human, I are human, so we are one.
Professor Zips, you have also been involved with reggae and Rastafari in Vienna since these early days, late 70s, early 80s, and then you have also worked academically on Rastafari, have published books about it, many articles, many books. How did you come to Rastafari, get to know Rastafari in Vienna, reggae in Vienna, and how did it influence you then that you said, oh, I would also like to work academically on it, and how has that journey developed from there?
I also want to pay respect to Emsley, who was like a godfather in many African-derived religions. You would call that person a godfather for the entire scene. So he was actually my link to Rasta. I want to be honest to you, when I first started to listen to reggae, which was 1974. It was mostly Mali, it was then big in the music scene, you know, every music magazine had a chapter on Mali.
It was the only thing we heard here.
Exactly, so I listened to Rastaman Vibration and even an album before, and it just didn't click with me. I didn't get it. It was too strange to me. I was a Rolling Stones fan, hardcore Rolling Stones, you know. Mick Jagger and Keith Richards and so forth. And you know, of course the appearance, you know, long hair was the same. So I listened to it in a record shop actually across the street. audio center or something like that, but it didn't make sense. I didn't buy the record. Then my friends, when I was like seven, in 76, they used to play Exodus back and forth. When we finished school, we went on a trip through Europe. The only thing I heard in the radio, on the tape player, cassette player actually, was Tim Buckley and Bob Marley. I was so tired of it. Exodus, I couldn't hear it anymore. So, you know, because it didn't make sense to me. I didn't know what Exodus means. I just, and the rhythm didn't click with me. I must really confess that. And then one day, I was interested in Africa though. One day I opened the Kurier, Tageszeitung, newspaper, Kurier, and there was a tiny little chapter saying a record shop opened the same place in Margaretenstraße selling African music. So I thought that must be Maasai music and you know what, Zulu moon music, stuff like that. And I went there, there was Emsley, I'm like Jamaican flag, Ethiopian flag. So I went in and said, and he was very friendly, very welcoming. Everybody will actually underline that, sign it. And I said, yeah, I came for African music. You have African music. He said, yeah, everything has African music. But it's not from Africa. I'm like, well, African music not from Africa. It's from Jamaica. And then, of course, I've heard about it. So I'm playing a little bit more stupid than I am, maybe, even at that day. But then he took a record as an example, which was Peter Tosh. Equal Rights, and he played that. And to me, that was probably one of the most decisive moments in my entire life. It actually changed my life from there. I was then a student of law, and justice, of course, is the key theme in law. But you never hear about it, really, because you hear about laws, not about justice. So listening to that Peter Tosh, what we need is equal rights and justice. We don't want no peace, but we want equal rights and justice. It really made like that.
But for here, we will close now. Thank you very much for joining us here at the Department of African Studies at the University of Vienna for this reasoning on the documentary film, Rebels Outta Vienna. And the reasoning, the panel discussion on Rastafari and Reggae in Vienna. Thank you all for coming, for sharing, and for participating with us here today. Thank you all.
Outta Vienna took place at the University of Vienna, followed by a panel discussion on June 15th, 2023. Rebels Outta Vienna, a documentary film taking stock of the Viennese reggae scene and its divergence with the Afro-Caribbean Rastafarian movement. The film explores local scene peculiarities in the context of global sounds and world views. It provides an intimate insight into views and narratives and thus makes a contribution to the audiovisual archiving of Vienna's music and cultural history. After the 30-minute film screening, there was a panel discussion from 7 to 8 p.m. It was a discussion on the topic of Rastafari and reggae in Vienna with the filmmaker Sebastian Schwager and with two of the protagonists of the film, such as Elder Ras Kella Waller and Rastafari musician Coleman, as well as anthropologist Professor Werner Zips, who also took part.
Also to mention, my name is Dominik Frühwirt, Rastafari Reasonings Project here at the Department of African Studies at the University of Vienna. And since it is a Rastafari Reasonings Project, we already been getting into the reasoning. The audience here, the audience on Zoom, you have now heard a little from our esteemed panelists. The floor is open. I'm sure some of you are already waiting to ask your own questions or add your own part of the history. As we have already heard, some of you in the audience have also been part of this history. Maybe you would also like to add, or maybe you have questions for our panelists. Let's get into our reasoning. Also, of course, from Zoom, if anybody has questions, can also come forward. You can also put them in the chat. Everything is possible.
Thank you very much. I am very delighted to be here and to hear all these nice and powerful words. I didn't know that everybody can be a Rastafari. So today I discover myself being a Rastafari because I'm a great rebel. I am rebelling against the global injustice and everything what you have said today. I'm also rebelling against gender injustice, and I see that all men are on the panel. Where are the women? And then my question is, what is the role of women in the Rastafari movement?
Even this had a big question I had to ask myself, even when I understand the Rastafarian movement and become, if you may say, a servant of it. Because at that time, it was, the women was not part of it, they didn't want it, and our philosophies was not interested in having them to be part of it, because the Rastafarian has a certain philosophy that they has to be a servant of the Lord, and they have to be disciplined and clean to be a servant, and they have to have a certain time, and if they have responsibility for women, that this will be differentiate them from time to serve God. For example, if you may say, Jesus Christ didn't get married, and things like that. So the Rasta, when it first started, was a man-dominating thing because we needed soldiers on the battle. We called ourselves soldiers to repatriate the world. But nowadays, we have had children, we have had married, we have had grandchildren. Now the Rasta have developed. But the movement started where it was single men trying to go forward to bring a generation. Why that? Maybe I'm really feeling sorry, we don't have a women there. I always don't like to go anywhere where there is not gender balance. Whenever I go any place and it's just men, I'm feeling displeased, dissatisfied. Because I respect the role of a woman, because the structure of any family doesn't go along without the woman. So I am encouraging, now you find yourself as a Rasta. I hope next time you'll be on the panel with us. Thank you, sir.
There were two women actually, so it's not true, but of course it's unfortunately it's the females are underrepresented in the movie, but to my point, to my view, it's just showing the reality of female presenters or female performers in the Viennese reggae scene, which are unfortunately very rare.
But I must say, now a panel like this would not represent Rasta, because that's the change over the past four decades. In the beginning it was fairly patriarchal, and women would keep very much in the background and refer to their king man to represent them, but today that's totally different. I mean, if reggae is symbolizing it, you have Janine, Hempress Sateira, so many powerful women. Many more. And even if you go to the music scene, theater scene, and so forth. Yeah, Lila Ike, yeah, for instance.
Example, yeah.
Yeah.
She's coming to Wiesn, the reggae festival.
So I guess, yeah. Well, then again, I guess you have tried. It's sometimes not so easy to get somebody to take part in it. Because my first feedback to the film was, you need to get more women in the film. Mm-hmm. And Sebastian said, but I mean, if nobody wants to talk, and that's a problem.
I was asking one of my friends why you have a very big part. Yeah, why? It is that has a signification, or it is only a trait? Because everyone I see who is a power man in your Rastafari has always this part.
I'll give you my reason why I don't shave and cut. I believe I was born in God's image and image and likeness. That's what we read. And I think, well, if I am born with something, or if I didn't born with it, but if it start growing with me while I'm growing, why should I destroy it? Why should I make myself a different person, not wanting to look how I should be looking? So this kind of shaving is a form of imaginary images out of our own creative image. And that's why I don't shave. I don't shave because I don't want to create an imaginary image. I want to live with the natural image as it grows. At one time, if it falls, it's okay. If it comes white, it's come black. I had long dreadlocks right down there. It's falling off, it's okay. But to destroy it, myself, is like I'm disliking my own image. And I believe if I destroy my image, I will not reach to the highermost image.
I just have like a question, because regarding the film, Sebastian, it was really interesting to see those different views of like the artist, and seeing that some were saying like, I have to be careful, so to say that I'm a Rasta is like, you know, I'm doing reggae, but to say I'm a Rasta, they have difficulties. Sometimes I had a feeling that to say I'm a Rasta, and they would say sometimes it would be even disrespectful for them to say that. And I, from the questions and from the different reasoning that we had, I had the feeling that, I remember, I didn't know what, for me, Rasta was reggae, was with the music, and I would have not said that it was open for everybody. And then I realized that, okay, what is a Rasta? And then I realized that Rastafari actually come from the name of Haile Selassie before he was crowned. I didn't even know about it. So, and with the different like exchange that I had, I understood that actually some people will say, if you call yourself a Rasta by his name, that you should then maybe understand what he's saying, so that you can then, you can really respect his name. And I feel like it comes back to all these questions nowadays that we see, appropriation. You know, you appropriate yourself something, but you don't really know about it. No, you had maybe dreadlocks, or you listen reggae, but you don't know about it. So I feel like all this, what you're saying about the reasoning, maybe from your perspective, I understood there is like different definition, but maybe there is more to think about and to reason about it. And I really upload videos like this, but how do you think that you can make people more aware what is Rastafari, not only through reggae, like through video, for example, like you're doing? How would you say that you will then maybe not define, or at least let people know what is it, Rastafari, so that there's also respect for that? Because I do believe that there's a lot of misconception of what is a Rastafari. And I come from Cote d'Ivoire, and we have a lot of reggae artists who bring this idea of what is Rastafari, but still I was not aware what was a Rastafari. If you had dreadlocks, even in Cote d'Ivoire in the 90s, I remember my brother had it, you have to cut it because it's like dirty, it's not nice. People don't know about like the struggle that people went through to be able to have dreadlocks. And even nowadays, Charlie said it, if you want to be in the society, you have to cut maybe your locks, or you have to cut your part.
Well, for me, I can say it's very simple. If Jack created me, and he created me perfect like everybody, and he made this thing grow. So if he didn't want me to have this, he wouldn't make it grow. It grows. you see. So I don't see, no. You can see I still shape it a little, because there was a time, I think you remember, maybe it was up to down there, you know, and then
dread beard,
yes, so, okay, since I came back in this society, and you still try to get a little job and things, you have to look a little more decent, okay, but I wouldn't cut it off completely, you know. There's no way. It's natural. It's growing, isn't it? So if Jah don't want you to have this, he wouldn't make it.
We have another occasion where you can watch it. It's at the Wiesn One Love Festival in August, and there might be some festivals coming in autumn where we present the movie. Just check out our website rebelsoutofvienna.com for the latest updates and make sure you stay alert.
Rastas were mostly marginalized people in Jamaican society. So they had a very strong voice, but that voice could not be heard because they had no media. So reggae gave them, and they invented reggae gave them a powerful medium, not only in Jamaica itself, but for the entire globe. And probably Bob Marley is the most played artist for the last century. So it's a very powerful medium. It still is. Maybe it was a bit more powerful in the 1980s, 1990s, but still, if you go to places like Benicassim in Spain, there are 40,000 people, 50,000 people listening to artists from all over the world. So reggae spread. It's not anymore purely Jamaican. A lot of people from African places play reggae. Tikinja, Fakoly, the famous Alpha Blondie, Lucky Dube, the late Lucky Dube in South Africa, and so many more.
True, you have Rasta on your head, won't make police to stop you somewhere to say, okay, he's a ganja smoker or whatever. So Rasta is kind of respected in Austria, I would say. You know, Rasta don't get too much fight in Austria. As the whole Austria is very peaceful, so Rasta live peaceful in Austria, I would say.
There's one thing I want to say that is unique when I came to Vienna. I really saw pure love with this Rastafarism that we are saying. I really saw from the heart. We meet almost every day. We go to the same club. I mean, if I remember, even I don't know whether I would have a money on me or food, we would never think. This brotherhood was so lovely, really, really lovely. And this is really what I really appreciated about the Rastafarism, the brothers around. Because I felt, oh, yes, this is not a church. You know, you just go to the church and go home and do different. But this is really people who welcome you. We go, you saw people were giving those, I mean, I cannot describe it. It was something that I found that, oh wow, you know, and this music role with Sala, Radim, Dele, Jubri, and Sakayosa, you know, things like that. So for me, it was a very nice experience. When you talk about Rastafarism, it's not just only, you know, red, gold, green, you have dreadlocks, and you know, you have a weed and things like that. But I saw really that what I saw, like Coleman said, he told him to read, you know, check the Bibles and that. In fact, we used to meet and really reason, you know, with the Bible. And this even I didn't even experience that even when I was in African Christian. So Vienna, pioneers, I appreciate it.
Moses, that ism on Rastafari, you can remove it because Rastafari don't really deal with ism and the schism. Better you say Rastafari, you know.
I'm not even aware of it.
Yeah, I just wanted it to share.
As he said, Professor Coleman is set the record straight. Ras Jahka, you could share a bit about the history of Rastafari and reggae music in Vienna that we didn't see in the movie, which is, as I said, mainly giving an impression of the current reggae scene in Vienna.
Musically, I can say, well, the first musicians that come with reggae music here, one of the first that I met as I've been living here, was Roots Mandele,
which he was going, he was playing a lot of cover version like Burning Spear, Bob Marley and those things. He was the first one, and we had a group, it was in 1984 about, called Wadada Rhythm. Gerhard was doing his group, too. I think it was Rhythm, huh? Rhythm. And there was little groups around, unfortunately, I told you last time when you see the video, we met too late, because all these things could have been put in. There was many groups, Pukunda Rhythm, I don't even remember all of them, you know, it's too many. They never come out big, you know. At that time, reggae was not a subject in the media in Austria.
And you said there were actually many, even more than to name reggae groups at that time. But
there
I guess
there was groups. There is, like I say, Ukunda, out of Ukunda, Prince Sekakon. Mm-hmm. It was his group at the time. Then who else we had here?
Slim Young.
Hmm? Solomon.
Slim Young.
Slim Young, for instance, yes.
We heard Songs of Solomon.
Songs of Solomon, that was our, if thanks Moses, that was our later thing. There was Double Standard, which you should have known. And I was surprised to not to find anything about it. I was playing with Double Standard. There was, I can't remember all of
them. Chosen Few.
Chosen Few.
Who? Chosen Few.
Chosen Few.
So you could say there were more than there are today.
I couldn't tell you who is there today.
But when you think now of Vienna in the 80s, I guess up into the 90s, it was not so cosmopolitan yet. Were there many people from Africa yet, or was it?
There was people from Africa here, and they were not all playing reggae. You know, some play Duncan and Mike.
Yes.
They were from Kenya, one playing drum, one playing guitar and singing in Bununu's life also. And there was always little projects coming on, an artist was coming from Jamaica, you know. In the early 80s, when this thing started in Arena, I think it was, the Black Music Festival or something, where you had many artists come from Jamaica, London, all over, which Emsley himself, he made a lot of the contacts. So I met many artists, you know, personally, and some of them we knew sit and reason, like Missing Those Religion many times, Steel Boys, Asbat, you know, all this. I met all from early days, you see. So they came here, and also that, I believe, brought a lot of Austrians to more, we can try something too, you know. Another group, I don't want to forget my good brethren, Brian Cox.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Brian Cox unit. I hope everybody forgive me who I forget. I don't remember. It was too many, quite a few. And who is there today? I know Coleman is there. Even this group from, I think, St. Pölten, they play with Anthony
House of Freedom.
House of Freedom, give thanks. There's many groups they are trying, you know, and some of them very progressive, good.
There was also a question, Brother Tuff.
About Rastafari, my question is it a way of life or a religion? Because many confuse this, Rastafari, Korma.
It is a religion, because Rasta say word, sound and power. That means every word you say, you must analyze it to the depth, know where it began. And because they say a word speaks 1,000 words, you know. So when you understand this word is the sound. And that sound is the power, the might, the God within you, because Bible tells you that the word is God. So now, saying that, knowing the meaning of religion, that it is bond, that now you connecting yourself to the history and understanding yourself. You know what I mean? So bond, because when people say religion, they are talking about religion, they're talking about the established religion. But the meaning of that word, Rasta leave it, because Rasta is connecting the memory, what you have, for preservation of your future. So that is the bond you have. You don't cut off your bond, because now you have a bond with your mother. You have a bond with your, because without them it wouldn't be. So you recognizing and appreciating these things, having respect and honoring it, this bond you have with your parents, which will in turn also be a blessing for your children. So you having it is religion in itself, is religio. That is the bond. So we are talking about the meaning of the word, it is religion. Talking about the movement, it is a movement. Talking about the way of life, it is way of life. It is everything. But in the real way, not in the way they used to deceive people, living up to it and as it supports life and brings light to the people.
I just want to add a little thing referring to Buta Baruka, whom you know very well, teacher Taf. I know you told me. He impressed you a lot. He would say, you know, Rasta is all about unity. What we were talking about the whole evening, even including people from, you know, there's a huge Rasta movement in Japan. Huge. And even if you go to Shashamane in Ethiopia, you would have Japanese people as Rastas there. Anyway, he would say Rasta is all about unity, but it's not about uniformity. And that's the big difference. So most Rastas that I met would say Rasta is not a religion, it is philosophy and culture. But then you talk to Burning Spear, who is not the least prominent Rastaman, and he talks about the Rasta religion. So Muta Baruka would say that's confusing to outsiders who want to categorize, open a box and say this is that, and so forth. And I guess the whole idea of Rastafari is in the reasoning. You come together as humanity, and that's a very beautiful idea that actually changed my life.
When it comes to the deep of Rasta, I'm not a Rasta man, then I will say again, because I'm Muslim in religion. When it comes to religion, so I come from Gambia and 95% is Muslim, so we are taught Muslim. But when I see Rasta, me and Rasta, we have same fight, almost same way of life, so I'm a Rasta still.
If you ask me what is Rastafari, I'm saying I am just learning, because I'm just in the school. I'm just in the movement, I'm in the institute, how you call it. I'm just learning
University
to become a Rasta man. Rasta man is a conclusion of everything, from religion to trade to lifestyle to everything. But if we want to categorize Rasta as a religion, we might have to even go as far as registering Rastafari. Rastafari is not a registered body. Religion is a registered organization that is functioning on a religious behavior for rituals. Our life is not rituals. Our life is living a pure, clean heart and life, showing love to our brotherly sisters. But if we want to say, we can say, yes, we are a religion, because a religion is a group of people who are coming together to discuss God. And we are religion that we are covering over all religions. We are a bit of all. We are the master of all of them. All the other small religions, they belong to us. They are trying to reach where we are going. So we Rastafarian, we are just the start pioneering movements. We are there from creation, but the Rasta movement in words is about from 1930. We don't have a church, we don't have a registered body, we don't have an affiliated organization. We are not institutionalized. So we cannot call ourselves a religion yet, if I may say the word religion rightly. But that movement is that movement will repatriate us, will rebel us, will make us what we have to be. If we have to be a religion, if we have to be an institution, if we have to be, then we'll get the names. But Rastafarian is the start and the rallying point to bring us to where we want to be. And I am just on the way learning. We are still learning. We are very young.
Thank you very much for joining us here at the Department of African Studies at the University of Vienna for this reasoning on the documentary film Rebels Outta Vienna, and the reasoning, the panel discussion on Rastafari and Reggae in Vienna. Thank you all for coming, for sharing, and for
participating with us here today. Thank you all.
And one last word.
Interested in the film, what's going on, where you can see again, or when is it going online, just check the website rebelsoutofvienna.com, where you can also find actually my bachelor thesis with the same title as a free PDF download if you're interested. Thank you.
Jamming.